Good morning. We rejoice in the blessing of our good God who is present among us here today. I'd like to start by welcoming any of you who are visiting with us today. We're delighted to have you, encourage you to fill out a yellow visitor pew card, place that in the offering plate. Also, this week, we are going to be entering the season of Lent with our Super Supper on Wednesday at 6 o'clock, followed by a worship service at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary. All are welcome to those. All people, all ages are welcome to those services. In the narthex, we have copies of our Lenten devotional book, Tattoos on the Heart. Encourage every household to have a copy of that wonderful resource for our own spiritual growth in the season of Lent. Finally, tickets for the doll tea party benefiting Angels of Mercy are available in the narthex after the service. And next Sunday, we are hosting the Houghton University Choir. We are having one service so that all our church can be together for that time of beautiful music, 10 a.m. February 26th, one service at 10 a.m. What time next week? 10 a.m. Would love to see you all here at 10 a.m. next Sunday. Now let us worship our Lord. Thank you.
Good morning. Can you please join me in body or spirit for the call to worship? The day has dawned. The morning star rises in our hearts. We witness the glory of Christ. God speaks to us in cloud and flame, in mysterious words and dazzling visions. We witness the glory of Christ. The Lord loves justice and equity and is exalted over all the people. We witness the glory of Christ. Praise the Lord. Now please join me in the gathering prayer. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, you are the glorious creator of all, the giver and sustainer of life. You dazzle us with your glory in the face of Jesus, healer, servant, and savior of the world. Fill us with your presence today, that we may share in the ministry of Christ and bear the in the world. Amen.
In the light of Christ, we see the shadows hidden in our hearts. Let us tell the truth about ourselves, trusting in God's grace that we might receive mercy and new life. Let us pray. Magnificent God, we cannot stand before the glory of your presence. You shine with divine light, and we are overcome by your goodness. Forgive us all our sin. Cleanse us and lift us up in your mercy. Fill us with your spirit, that we might reflect your light and share your love for the sake of Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Friends, believe the good news. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone and a new life has begun. Know that we are forgiven and be at peace. Amen. Amen.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. O God of the covenant, the cloud of your splendor and the fire of your love revealed your Son on the mountain heights. Transform our lives in his image. Write your law of love on our hearts and make us prophets of your glory, that we may lead others into your presence. Amen. The Old Testament scripture is Psalm 99. The Lord is king. Let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he. Mighty King, lover of justice, you have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Extol the Lord our God. Worship at his footstool. Holy is he. Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel was also among those called on his name. They cried to the Lord, and he answered them. He spoke to them in the pillar of cloud. They kept his decrees and the statutes that he gave them. O Lord our God, you answered them. You were a forgiving God to them, but an avenger of their wrongdoings. Extol the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy.
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Children, will you come and join me here at the front of the sanctuary? Good morning. Good to see you both. Oh, I'm so glad to see you both. Would you like to have a seat here with me?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, you okay? Okay. So take a look up here. Actually, you know what? Let's stand up because we can't see it so well from that spot. Let's walk up together and look around. Last week we saw a lot of green up here. Do you see a new color that stands out? Maybe here at the communion table or back there? You see white. Oh, come join us. Welcome. White all over up here in the arrangement, in my stole. Wonderful. Well, why don't we have a seat together? And we're going to talk about that white color a moment. So it's bright. I sure am. Here, do you want to have a seat? So white is the color we are going to hear in our story today about Jesus and three of his disciples who go up a mountain and they see something incredible. Jesus' clothes become brilliant white. His face just shines with God's glory. And two people from the Old Testament appear, Moses and Elijah. We're about to hear this wonderful story of Jesus, it's a big word, transfiguration. Can you say it with me? Transfiguration. It just means a change of appearance, and Jesus, his appearance, is going to change. Let's listen for that story together, but first let's pray. Will you repeat after me?
Yes.
Thank you, Lord, for your love and goodness revealed in Jesus. Open our ears and our hearts to your word. Amen. Thank you, friends. You may return to your seats.
How could we hear?
Oh, my goodness. That's a good question. You'll hear it. Yes, that's right. Thank you. let all God's people say, Amen. Our gospel reading this morning comes from Matthew chapter 17, beginning with verse 1. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, Get up and do not be afraid. And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. All my life, mountains have been friends. I grew up in the shadow, the shelter of the Blue Ridge, which my mother taught me were among the oldest in the world. Once as tall as the Alps, their peaks worn smooth by eons of erosion. As a young adult, I hiked in the misty mountains of Mourne in Northern Ireland and in the sun-baked Santa Catalinas north of Tucson. Now, our family loves the Adirondacks with their massive glacial boulders and high peaks. All my life, mountains have been friends. Perhaps the same is true for you as you sense the call, the enjoyment, the beauty, the beckoning of the mountains. The great American naturalist and early pioneer of protecting the wilderness, John Muir, once wrote, The mountains are calling, and I must go. And we may know that same sense, that pull, that calling. In the Bible, mountains appear over and over again as places where God reveals his presence to people. In the ancient world, the cosmos was envisioned like a layer cake, with the underworld below and the heavens up above and human existence in between. And so people thought that going up on a mountaintop literally got them closer to heaven and closer to God. Now, we, of course, benefit from a modern scientific understanding of the nature of the universe, but that same spiritual sense of being closer to God in the mountains may still resonate with us as true. The mountains are calling. It is perhaps no surprise, then, that Jesus takes with him Peter and James and John and goes up a mountain for this moment of divine revelation. Transfiguration, and that there on that mountain, he is joined by two Old Testament figures who are known for their mountaintop experiences with God. Moses, who heard the divine voice speaking from a burning bush and who received the law on Mount Sinai, and Elijah, who climbed a mountain once at God's calling and heard the still small voice, the sound of sheer silence that was the presence of the Lord. Moses and Elijah know the holiness that is present on the mountains. This scene that unfolds is in the biblical tradition of apocalyptic literature, but in the Bible, apocalypse is very different from how we hear and think of it in our culture today. Apocalypse actually just means revelation, a pulling back of the curtain so that we see a truth that is already there, but that our eyes cannot usually see. Fire, brimstone, zombies, not required. This view, though, of the apocalypse as a terrible, cataclysmic unfolding of disasters, though, is so common in our culture that early on in the pandemic, that language was common. About a month or two into the spring of 2020, just after the pandemic had begun, my husband, Mike, and I were out on a walk in our neighborhood. We passed by the home of a neighbor we did not yet know, a couple streets over. He was out pulling weeds and spreading mulch. We nodded and waved, and he called out to us, "How are you enjoying the apocalypse?" He didn't know that we were pastors and had a different view of the apocalypse, the pulling back of the curtain to see a truth that is present, which is what we see in our story today. On the mountain, as God pulls back this glorious curtain so that we see beneath the human flesh of Jesus the dazzling presence of God. Here, Peter, James, and John have a very common response to apocalyptic moments. They are dazzled and frightened, and they fall down in fear until Jesus comes and touches them and literally raises them up. In the words of the old spiritual, they tremble. Tremble as they will a few weeks later at the other side of Lent when they join Jesus on another mountain, the mountain of Golgotha, the mountain of Calvary. These two stories of the Transfiguration and of the Mount of Golgotha stand as bookends to the season of Lent. And there are many parallels between the two. Here at the Transfiguration, Jesus' clothes are dazzling and white. There he will be flanked by criminals, one hanged on either side. Here, Moses and Elijah stand beside Jesus. Oops, I already gave you that one. Sorry. Here, God proclaims, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." And at Jesus' death, those same words of him being God's son will be a criticism and a mockery. If you are the Son of God, bring yourself down from the cross. In both stories, Jesus is accompanied by three followers. Here, three men. There, three women. Here, Peter, James, and John. There, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, and Salome, who is the mother of James and John. These two mountains on either side of Lent. These two moments when God pulls back the curtain and lets us see. Here, Jesus glorified. There, Jesus despised and rejected. On this Mount of Transfiguration, Jesus already knows that the other mountain is calling. In fact, he talks about it here with his disciples, that this other mountain, the Mount of Golgotha, is calling, and he must go. We hear this part of the story immediately after the Transfiguration as Jesus descends the mountain with these three disciples. And this is the story that unfolds. When they came to the crowd, a man came to him, knelt before him, and said, "Lord, have mercy on my son, for he has epilepsy, and he suffers terribly. He often falls into the fire and often into the water, and I brought him to your disciples, but they could not cure him." Jesus gets angry at this, frustrated not at the father and his little boy, but at his disciples for their lack of faith, their inability to bring healing or help to this family. And Jesus cures him instantly. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, "Why could we not cast it out?" He said to them, "Because of your little faith. For truly I tell you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. There's that word mountain again, though in a different sense, not as the mountain of God's divine revelation, but as the mountain of trouble in front of this family, that big, daunting summit ahead of them of their little boy's devastating illness. We see here the shift from mountain as place of divine presence to mountain as a place of trouble, of suffering. Not literal mountains being moved, not the Appalachians or the Alps being moved for dramatic effect, but mountains of trouble over time moved by the faith of the disciples. The mountains are calling the disciples of the ancient world, calling us today. Mountains of problems in our lives, in the world that feel immovable, unchangeable, as daunting perhaps to us as Everest. Jesus says, though, that if you have faith, if we have faith, even the size of a mustard seed, we can move mountains. Now, perhaps in our lifetimes, we will not see those mountains move. Perhaps their shifting forms will be imperceptible to our eyes. And yet, like the Blue Ridge washed smooth by the eons, the power of the rushing baptismal waters, the power of the blowing wind, Spirit of God steadily erodes, moves those mountains. Indeed, we hear this in the words of the prophet Isaiah. At the coming of God, every mountain and hill shall be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together. Mountains teach us to be patient. The problems before which we may tremble, the heaps of trouble in our own lives and in our wider world, can be moved little by little, stone by stone, baptismal water by blowing wind of the Spirit. Mountains teach us to trust in the slow work of God. God who appears not only in dazzling apocalyptic visions, but in the slow, persistent, deep work of the Spirit. 20th century Jesuit priest Teilhard de Chardin writes this, a prayer and an encouragement for those of us who hear the mountains of trouble calling, mountains perhaps of challenge or need or desire or longing. He writes, above all, trust in the slow work of God. Give our Lord the benefit of believing that his hand is leading you, and accept the anxiety of feeling yourself in suspense and incomplete. May we trust in the slow work of God, and together with our Lord, may we move mountains. Amen.
Thank you.
us now affirm our faith together using these words from Colossians chapter 1. Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. In him, all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the first place of the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. Amen. Please be seated. As we come now to our time of lifting up joys and concerns to our Lord, what burdens do we want to share with our God today and invite God's prayer and help? Any from this section? What about from this section? Yes, Lynn. Lynn is here. We are so glad.
I wanted to thank everybody for their hearts, their calls, their meals. This is a wonderful church, and it just grows into a fabulous family.
Thanks be to God for God's healing work, for you, Linda, and also for the blessing of this church family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Yes, Kurt.
I'd like prayers for Sunday school teacher Jimmy Carter as he enters hospice care, and for all thousands of his students.
Prayers for Jimmy Carter entering hospice care and for the profound impact he has had in so many ways, including as a Sunday school teacher. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Other joys and concerns. What about in this section? Sherry. Prayers for a sister-in-law, Catherine, who had a stroke this week and is now on hospice care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Autumn. Prayers for Aunt Loopy at the loss. Aunt Ruthie at the loss of her daughter, for God's comfort. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Joys and concerns from this section. What about from this section? Yes, Steve.
Prayers to my brother-in-law, Charlie, and my sister, Debbie. Charlie has been in a rehab context for the last 5 months and is transitioning home this week. And the we're thankful for some healing that has taken place, but the transition home is in of itself going to be a time of some great stress and difficulty. So prayers for both of them.
Prayers for Charlie and Debbie as Charlie's transitioning home, for God's grace and provision in the midst of that. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Robin.
Prayers, Thanksgiving that my daughter was able to find, as her lease was expiring monthly, she's found another place to move. Prayers for smooth transition from airport to home.
Giving thanks for a new place to live for your daughter and for a smooth move for her. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Yes, Kathy. A heartbreaking loss in the parenting community this week. We lift up Maddie's family, teachers, students, for God's healing, comforting presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. London. So prayers of healing for Kendall. And then also, Sylvia, was that your brother?
Yep.
Oh, Sylvia, our love and prayers are with you for God's comfort. Tell us his name.
Dan.
Prayers for the family of Don, for Sylvia, and all those who loved him. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Any other joys and concerns today? Kurt.
A prayer of joy that seemingly half the church was present to enjoy Sarah's virtuosity. Prayer of hope that we have an encore.
We did indeed have a wonderful showing, at least 25 people from PPC at Nazareth College on Friday evening for a wonderful, wonderful concert, giving thanks for the gifts God has given us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us gather our hearts now in prayer before our Lord. Holy God, we thank you for this glorious world that you have made. Light and beauty and wonder and splendor revealed to us throughout the ages in the gift of your word to us, and most fully in the gift of Jesus Christ, in whom we see the fullness of your glory as bright as we can bear. Lord, we thank you for the divine revelation, the apocalypse of his identity on that Mount of Transfiguration. Lord, help us to see Jesus in our own daily lives, to see your glory and your grace and presence with us. We thank you, O Lord, for the goodness among us, for the gift of music, for the gift of a church family to love and support us, for the good news of Linda's healing, and for the blessing of a new home for a beloved daughter, and pray your blessing upon her in this move. Lord, we thank you for the many gifts that you pour out for grace and new beginnings and your welcome and love. Lord, we know there are so many places of pain and need in our world today. We pray, O Lord, for the nation of Ukraine, and we pray for peace between Ukraine and Russia, for your mighty work of restoration and liberation. We pray for the nations of Turkey and Syria following the devastating earthquake there. We pray, O Lord, for all those responding and helping and serving in that place, for your protection and provision. We pray for those around our world today who are suffering from the forces of warfare, of famine, of violence, and ask that your spirit might move mountains that feel insurmountable to us. Lord, strengthen us with faith, even faith the size of a mustard seed that grows strong and vibrant within us. God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon those who are suffering or struggling today. Especially, O Lord, we name before you those in hospice care, for Jimmy and for Catherine. We pray for comfort and your healing power, for Charlie and Debbie, for the family of Maddie, for Kendall, for an aunt, for Sylvia and her family at the loss of Don, and for all those other burdens that are known to us and that we now lift before you in silent prayer. Lord, we pray that you would strengthen us for the week ahead with faith and trust in you, trust in your slow work, trust that you are working all things together for good. And we pray together now the prayer that Jesus taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, in gratitude for all that God has done, all God's goodness in our midst, let us give from what we have received. Our offering today will benefit both the local ministry of the church as well as response to the earthquakes in Turkey and Syria with partnership through Presbyterian Disaster Assistance. If you wish to make a special gift to that purpose, simply indicate that or use one of the offering envelopes that we shared last week, or if you need one, we have several extra here today. Now let us give joyfully from what we have received. Plates are brimming with envelopes decorated by our children. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Loving God, we lift these offerings to you, thankful, praying that through them your touch of love and healing might be felt throughout this world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. look forward to seeing you back here in the sanctuary at 10 o'clock next Sunday morning as we welcome the Houghton University Choir and join together in praise of our Lord. Now go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing only in the power of God's Holy Spirit. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace, now and forever. Alleluia. Amen.
Recording stopped.